Today, we are very excited to have a guest with us, a guest speaker. Dr. Les Parrott is here this morning, and he was with us this weekend, Friday night and Saturday, for a marriage conference. And all of those who attended were incredibly encouraged, incredibly blessed as we learned how to fight the right way, right? It's not about if you'll fight, it's when you fight and doing it the right way. And so praise God for all of the peace that now reigns. The married people are smiling. Praise God for that. Dr. Les Parrott and his wife, Leslie, are number one best-selling authors on the New York Times. They have had several books that have gone number one, and those are for sale here after the service in the Hub. Hope you'll take advantage of that. They've appeared on the Oprah Winfrey Show, The View, The Today Show, CNN, and they are known worldwide just as specialists for families and relationships. And the reason we're doing this weekend, and the reason I invited Dr. Parrott to speak to us today, is because our church has a vision. And our vision is to strengthen families, to be a family training center. And so today is part of that vision, to encourage you in whatever family season you're in right now or whatever your family looks like. We know that God has some encouragement for all of us in all of our relationships. So would you put your hands together and welcome Dr. Les Parrott as he comes to speak to us this morning.
Thanks, man. Appreciate it. Thanks, everybody. Thank you very much. How are you? What a great day to be in church, and what a great church to be in. This has been a really honor, a great honor to be in your city and to be in this church talking to so many couples. Just let me get a feel. How many were in our weekend event, just so I have a sense of that? All right, fantastic. Well, this morning we're going to talk about relationships, not marriage necessarily, just relationships in a broader context. And just to make sure you all have the right attitude, just turn to the person next to you and just say, you really need this. I thought that would help you feel a little bit better. So Leslie and I, and by the way, we have the same name in case you're confused. I'm Leslie and she's Leslie, and that's just the way it is. But we started a course at our university where we teach in Seattle some years ago. In fact, we realized early on as we were teaching on this Christian college campus that it seemed to us as though we were teaching these students as a faculty, we were teaching them everything in the world except how to have healthy relationships. And we thought, why is that? You ever thought about that? Why don't we have courses on college campuses on relationships? I mean, we teach accounting and we teach nursing and we teach all the rest, but the hub of the wheel for all of us is relationships. Doesn't matter what your major is, and it doesn't matter what your job ends up being. It doesn't matter how much money you make or whether you have a boat or whether you have multiple houses or anything else. The number one source of fulfillment and contentment on this planet is relationships. And we thought, why in the world are we not teaching courses on this? And so we thought, let's change that. And let's offer a class. We'll call it Relationships 101. Now, if you know anything about academic settings, you know you don't just dream up classes and start teaching them, right? You got to get them approved by the provost and the deans and the committees and all that kind of stuff. And so we put a little proposal together for this course we want to teach called Relationships 101. And we outlined all the lectures that we thought would be appropriate. We wanted to give a lecture on how to keep family ties from pulling strings. You know that your home that you grew up in was your university of relationships? You learn more about relationships from that home, for good or for ill, than you'll learn from any seminar or any sermon or any book the rest of your days. And in fact, imagine if you could go back to the home that you grew up in. Can you picture it? And you were to take kind of an emotional tour through there to think about the relationship lessons that were taught in that home, not necessarily intentionally. What would the lessons be? And maybe you'd even go up into the attic, at least the figurative attic, and you'd look around up there and you'd see all this memorabilia from your childhood and a ball glove or a dollhouse or a scout's uniform or whatever it might be. And then over in the corner, you'd find this big dusty trunk. And on the side of it, it would have this placard, and it would have your name engraved in it. And underneath it, it would say, Relationship Curriculum. Can you imagine? And you'd open that thing up, And you find all these file folders of all these different courses that you took as a kid growing up about relationships. Maybe you pull out a file folder and here's a course you took called Advanced Blame Shifting and How to Do It, you know? We took courses in all kinds of stuff. Growing up, it was modeled and not modeled, and so we absorbed that. So we want to lecture on how to keep family ties from pulling strings. We also wanted to give a lecture on friendship. Now, can you imagine life without friends? I mean, it really is true. They double our joy and they cut our grief in half. And we thought, let's lecture on the difference between friends of the heart and friends of the road. You see, there's certain friends that we have for a while, and we're tight, but for some reason, life takes a turn, and one of us goes this way, and one goes that way, and we just kind of lose track of him or her, and wonder what happened to Jim. Haven't thought about him for a while, you know? Those are friends of the road. And then we have friends of the heart, and it doesn't matter how far apart you move, you pick up right where you left off, and you keep in touch through email and all the rest, and why is that? What's the difference between those two friendships? I wanted to lecture on that. We thought we should probably lecture on what do you do when your friends fail you? Now, if that hasn't happened to you yet, put your seatbelt on. Because it's coming. It's just an inevitable part of life. You're on this planet long enough, you're going to have a friend that fails you. One of my personal philosophies of living is that we all have our own private Gethsemane. And we all have our own Judas. And we wake up some morning and we go, how could he have done that to me? I trusted him with my money. I trusted her with my secrets. How could they have done this to me? Right? What do you do when your friends fail? We thought we should also lecture on a college campus about dating. We want to give a lecture on how to fall in love without losing your mind. How do you improve that love IQ? You know, how do you make wise decisions in the midst of this dizzying experience of falling in love? And we thought, just like with friendship, we should probably give a lecture on how to break up and stay in one piece. So many of these students go through that experience, and there's good ways and bad ways of doing that. What if you're the heartbreaker? What if you're the brokenhearted? You know, what do you do? And is there a good way and bad way to go through that? Yeah, there's lots of research on that. So all these different realms of relationship that we could think of, sexuality, bridging the gender gap, relating to God without feeling phoned, all the different realms of relationship that we could think of, we put on this proposal, we brought it to this committee, they looked it over, they studied it for a little while, finally looked up at us and said, thanks but no thanks. We said, why not? They said, well, it's just not... doesn't have enough rigor. I said, what do you mean? They said, well, it doesn't have enough academic rigor to the course. I said, well, you know, we can put some information in there that'll confuse the students if you like. And they said, well, there's not even a textbook for a class like that. I said, well, we'll write our own if we need to. And they said, well, other schools don't have classes like this. I said, well, maybe they should, maybe they will. They said, well, it's just not gonna work here. And so we left kind of feeling dejected after putting so much energy into this thing. And we just couldn't quite let go of it, and we retooled it a little bit, came back to him on a second round the next semester, and again, thanks, but no thanks. We went through this three times that academic year, and finally, on the third round, I think we just kind of wore him down, and they said, okay, here's the deal. We can tell you're really passionate about teaching this class. If you want to teach this relationships class so badly, here's the deal. We're going to let you do it, but under these conditions. Number one, the class will need to be pass-fail. So that means it doesn't impact anybody's grade point average. Number two, it'll need to be a general elective, meaning that it's not required for anybody's major or graduation or anything like that. Number three, they said, it'll need to be taught as an overload. Every prof understands that. That's in addition to your full-time responsibilities. Number four, you'll need to teach it on your own time schedule, meaning once all the other classes on the campus have been filled and assigned a classroom, if you can find an empty space and a time that works, you can teach it there. And, oh yeah, and then lastly, they said you'll need to teach it without compensation. So with that pat on the back, we set off to teach this class, Relationships 101. We put the course description in the catalog, and we just waited to see if any students might sign up for this thing. We found a room 6:30 in the evening on Mondays. Not really prime time on an undergraduate campus for a course. And it had about 12 chairs in there, and we just thought if we can fill half of them at least, we'll be up and running and get this thing going. And so we just waited to see if anybody would sign up. It was about 9:30, 10 o'clock in the morning on the first day of registration when the registrar called my office, and he said, hey, Doc, he said, we're going to have to move your classroom. And I said, oh, what happened? Nobody signed up? You need the space for something else? He said, no. He said, this is just the first day of registration. We got four more days of it to go, and I just wanted you to know that you didn't limit the number of students that could take the class. I said, what does that have to do with anything? He said, 350 students have registered for your class. He said, by default, the computer just moved you into the auditorium and moved the class that was in there into that little classroom that you had. And I said, keep talking. And that was over 20 years ago that happened. We've been teaching that class on Monday nights at 6:30 ever since. There's always a waiting list to get in there. It's the largest class on our campus. And doesn't it speak volumes about the hunger, the thirst we have for information on healthy relationships? Healthy relationships. On the very first night of this class, we tell these students, it doesn't really matter to us whether you take any notes, because it's up to you. This is a pass-fail course. You're going to get out of it whatever it is that you'd like to get out of it. So it's really up to you whether you take any notes, except tonight, on the very first night of this class, we want you to write down at least one single sentence. And we tell them this sentence that we're about to give you, it has the potential to revolutionize every relationship you ever attempt to build. It has the potential to transform your relationship with mom and dad and your siblings and your roommate, your teammates, your potential soulmate someday. It has that. If you can allow the truth of this sentence to kind of seep down into your cortex and be lived out through your spirit, it has that kind of transformative power. And they all get poised with their pencils and they're all ready to take down the sentence, and we finally give it to them. I want to give it to you this morning. Here it is. If you try to build intimacy with another person before you've done the difficult work of getting whole on your own, all your relationships become an attempt to complete yourself. Let me say it again. If you try to build a connection, if you try to build intimacy with another person before you've done the difficult work of getting whole or getting healthy on your own, all your relationships become an attempt to complete yourself, and they'll fall flat. Guaranteed. Why? Because nobody was designed to complete you. Sorry to break it to you, because I know that's a romantic notion, but nobody was designed to complete you. By the way, the last time I taught this class, gave this little lecture and gave that sentence, 2 weeks later, a student comes up to me, and he says, hey, Doc, can I show you something? I said, yeah, what's going on? He goes, you know that sentence that you gave? I said, yeah. He goes, that really impressed me. He says, that really spoke to me. And I said, oh, well, that's wonderful. He said, can I show you something? I said, yeah, of course. What is it? And he pulled up his shirt, and he had the sentence tattooed on his rib cage. I said, brother, I got other things to say. You should wait the whole semester, right? I know it takes the romantic notion out of that, that this other person, that there's not somebody that's supposed to complete you that makes up for all that you're lacking. That's a tough pill to swallow, because we're fed this kind of fairy tale notion. You know, we read it in books from when we're little, and then even as adults, we see it in movies and novels. And so, in fact, but probably the most iconic movie that illustrates this is, remember Jerry Maguire? Remember that movie came out? It's real. In fact, I call this the Jerry Maguire syndrome, because it's so common. You see it on college campuses, but it's at, and by the way, that movie's the most quoted movie in all of cinematic history. Everybody came out of the theater back when that thing came out, quoting that one line, show me the money, right? Every romantic came out of there quoting another line. What was it? There you go. You complete me, right? You had me at hello. Remember that? It was in the same thing. And you remember the scene, Tom Cruise, he's a sports agent. He's fallen in love with Renee Zellweger's character, and the two of them are getting married. They got married, and they're struggling in that first few months of marriage, something Leslie and I can identify with, by the way. The very first line of our book, Saving Your Marriage Before It Starts, says, we never had pre-marriage counseling, but we spent the first year of our marriage in therapy, and that's the truth. So we get that. And he's realizing he's having some great success on the road as a sports agent, and realizes he's got to repair things on the home front. And so he comes home from his trip early, and he walks up the stairs of his little bungalow where they're living, and he's got his suitcase and his overcoat on. He walks in the front door, and he realizes he's walked into the middle of this support group. All these women are sitting around, and they're commiserating about how miserable men can be. Remember the scene? And he walks into the midst of that, and he puts his luggage down, and he says, "I'm looking for my wife." And there he sees her kind of behind the lamps over there, and she pokes her head out. And then he launches into this amazing speech. I have enough friends in Hollywood to know this took probably 3.5 months to craft this speech, all right? And he gets to the climax of this speech, and he says those words, "You complete me." He says them with such pathos. He says them with such... Can anybody say it like Tom Cruise said it? Anybody? Pastor, can you say it like Tom Cruise? No? I'm going to give it my best shot. In fact, I'm going to look in the camera. Is this a good one right here? He looks at her as if she's the only woman on the planet. All these women, their jaws have dropped down to the floor, right? As he's saying these things. And he looks at her and he says, "You complete me." That's exactly how he said it, and I look a lot like him too, I know. And every romantic, when they hear that line, what do? Oh, I wish somebody would say that to me. Oh, I'd love to say that to somebody else. Now, I'm no psychologist or anything, but if you... Well, I guess I am. But but if you say that, if you believe, if you buy into that, I got to tell you, you're setting yourself up for serious heartache. Sure, it's fine to say those things. I'm not knocking the romantic notion of it, but if that's the thing you're buying into for this relationship, you're setting yourself up for serious heartache because nobody was designed to complete you. Ultimately, we want to remind you on this Sunday morning that ultimately your compulsion for completion is met in a relationship with your Heavenly Father. And if you've been going to church very long, you go, "Yeah, heard this message before." You get this relationship right, and these relationships get better. And we say that because it's so true, right? It's just powerful. In fact, what happens is when we don't do that, I'm looking at the audience here. Can I borrow, are you guys a married couple? Can I borrow you for like 4 seconds? I know you're going, "Why did we sit on the front row?" Just come right up here for a second. Just stand right here. How long have you guys been married? 31 years, awesome. So just stand right here. You don't have to touch each other and face the audience. You can let go of each other's hands. And then just, you're perfect. And then just lean your, keep your feet where they are. Nope, keep your feet where they are. And then just lean your shoulders in against each other, all right? And then gently put your heads together, all right? And we see a couple walking around like that, and what do we say? All right, you're making us sick, sit down, all right? I could take you around to college campuses and show you students that literally walk around like that. They're what Leslie and I call A-frame relationships. And if they don't do that literally, at least figuratively, and they go to the dining hall together and the library together and all that, what happens, nothing wrong with it, but what happens in a relationship where at least figuratively you walk around like that, leaning in on each other? What happens when you stumble, when one person stumbles? Yeah, the whole relationship kind of gives way, right? Because there's no individuation, there's no individuality. They've kind of enmeshed or fused their identities with each other. And we go, "Oh, isn't that sweet? Isn't that romantic?" But it creates a really unstable relationship, as we're about to see. Have you guys ever heard of the name Neil Clark Warren? Have you ever heard that name before? If you haven't heard his name, maybe you've heard of his company that he founded. It's called eHarmony. Ever heard of eHarmony? Any eHarmony couples in here? All right. Leslie and I were sitting at the dining room table in Pasadena, California, when the idea for that company was first talked about. And Neil started to cast this vision, and a great vision to reduce the divorce rate and so forth. In the context of that conversation, that night, I remember asking Neil, I said, "Hey, if you could only give one word of advice to a couple about to be married, what would it be?" And he thought for about a split second. I mean, it was on the tip of his tongue, and he said, "Get yourself healthy before you get yourself married." And I said, wow, I said, that you and I speak the same language here. I said, do you ever get the question from people, how do you get healthy? He goes, all the time. I said, why don't we, as two Christian psychologists, build a toolkit on how to get emotionally, psychologically, relationally, spiritually healthy? Why is this important, by the way? Because your relationships can only be as healthy as you are. Let me say that again. Your relationships can only be as healthy as you are. Therefore, one of the most important things you will ever do in your relationships is work on who you are in the context of them. And so that little conversation around that dining room table that night turned into a really late night conversation that spun into more than 2.5 years of research and another year of writing, and we eventually wrote put a book together, and it's our answer on how to get spiritually and emotionally healthy. And we put this information together, we traveled all around the country, and we interviewed experts, and we had stacks of research and all that kind of stuff, and then we're trying to figure out, you know, how do you make it accessible and put the proverbial cookies on the bottom shelf for people, and we began to kind of think through what it is, and we came up with three things that we found are essential to being emotionally, psychologically, spiritually healthy as a human being. And we literally published the book, Tyndale Publishers, and less than 3 months after the book had come out, I was on the airplane, and I was reading from this very Bible right here, and I turned to Ephesians chapter 3, and you can do the same thing if you have your Bibles in front of you, and I went, oh, there's those three things I thought we discovered in our research together. Apparently the Apostle Paul got to it before we did, and it just happens time and time again in my life, literally, but it happened after the book had come out. But that, I want to show you what happens when we get a lock on these three things, because I think that for some of you this morning, this can be transformative. I think that your relationships will take you to a different level once you begin to wrap your head around these three things. Three things you got to get a lock on. And the first of these is what we call profound significance. I'm going to look at that passage of scripture in just a moment, but profound significance. If you want to be healthy emotionally and spiritually, you've got to get a lock on how profoundly significant you are in the eyes of God. That God loves you as if you're the only person on the planet to love, as St. Augustine said. You know, that's sometimes a struggle for some of us, right? And some of you might be going, well, yeah, I've heard the message before, but you don't know my story. Well, you're right. I get that. But profound significance, God loves you as if you're the only person on the planet to love. If you struggle like that, like I do sometimes, with God's amazing grace, let me challenge you to tune into the single most important conversation you ever have. You had it this morning before we came in here. You're going to have it this afternoon after brunch. You had it yesterday, and you're going to have it tomorrow. In fact, this conversation never turns off. It's 24/7 every day out of the year. It's your self-talk. It's that internal dialogue that plays over and over in your head. Imagine if before you went to bed tonight, you could take a little computer chip out of the back of your head and slip it in your laptop, and it would tabulate your conversation, your internal dialogue, the conversations inside your head for the last 24 hours. Can you imagine? And it would simply categorize your self-talk as positive or negative. Which one of those buckets would be most full for you at the end of any given day? Might surprise you to know, if you're like most people, at least 73% of your self-talk would fall into that negative bucket. We know this from research at UCLA. But not the person who has a lock on profound significance. Not the person who not only realizes that God loves them, but they feel it deep down in their bones. Not because they've memorized the scripture. They know Romans 8. There is therefore now no condemnation for who? Those of us that are in Christ Jesus, they know that. And they can sing about God's amazing grace, and they can do all that stuff. That's one thing to kind of go through that, but it's quite another thing to feel it deep down in your spirit, that God loves me as if I'm the only person on the planet to love. Profound significance. Look at this verse that Paul gives us in Ephesians chapter 3. It's in verse 17. I'm reading this out of the Message. And he says this. He says, I ask him that with both feet planted firmly on love, that you'll be able to take in with all Christians the extravagant dimensions of Christ's love. I love that phrase, extravagant dimensions of Christ's love. Reach out and experience the breadth. Test the length. Plumb the depths. Rise to the heights. And then listen to this sentence. He says, live full lives, full in the fullness of God. Live full lives, full in the fullness of God. It's as if he's wanting to make sure we don't miss the point here. He's talking about our compulsion for completion. Because if we think we can kind of lean in on another person to complete us, right, eventually what happens is we start to pound down on that person. And hey, why aren't you doing what you're supposed to do, right? And this isn't what I signed up for. And you better do what you're supposed to do, or else this relationship isn't going to work out for us. And you create all this pressure, and that's no way to live, right? Because ultimately, you can kind of transform that A-frame relationship to what we might call an M-frame relationship, represented by the capital letter M. And so if one of you stumbles, the other person's strong enough to pick him up, and as iron sharpens iron, we help each other on our pathway to wholeness. But we don't look to that person to be our shortcut to doing that. Why? Because they can't do it. That's too much pressure. Ultimately, our compulsion for completion is met in a relationship with our Heavenly Father. So, profound significance. Second thing you got to get a lock on, not just profound significance, but what we call unswerving authenticity. If you want to be healthy, emotionally, relationally, spiritually healthy, you've got to get a lock on unswerving authenticity. Now, the first one, profound significance, that has to do with your relationship with God. Unswerving authenticity has to do with your relationship with you. This is being true to you. I can't tell you how many people I've had come into my counseling office struggling with that proverbial disease to please. Some of you know exactly what I mean. Because you walk around on the planet and you're thinking, oh, wow, man, if I could just get so-and-so's approval, that would just mean the world to me. Or maybe if I accomplished this over there, this group would accept me and I could kind of be a member of that group. Or maybe if I chose this pathway, Mom and Dad would give me their blessing finally and I'd feel good about that. Or so-and-so might smile in my direction. They live their life constantly trying to please other people, but not the person who has a lock on unswerving authenticity. Most of our books that Leslie and I have written are published with a company up in Grand Rapids, Michigan called Zondervan Publishing House. And so because of that, we make a trip to Grand Rapids at least a couple times a year and for various meetings and so forth. And quite some time ago, we were back there for a meeting and we'd met all day and worked hard with this group, maybe 10 or 12 people around this conference table. And we all went out to dinner afterwards, this Chinese restaurant, and we'd all placed the orders, and just to kind of get the conversation going, I turned to Bruce, the president of the company at the time, and I said, Bruce, tell me, what's new and exciting at Zondervan these days? I said, we've been so focused on our own projects, but what's getting you guys excited at the company? And then a hush kind of fell over the table. Everybody was like, tell him, you know? And he said, well, we're just about to release this new book. It's called The Purpose-Driven Life. And we're pretty excited about it. And I said, I don't know who the author is. I'm sure you're going to tell me in a minute. And I don't know what the message is. But I just got a whole sermon in a book title, The Purpose-Driven Life. Who doesn't want purpose in their life? See, that's what we're talking about here when we talk about unswerving authenticity. Is knowing why on earth am I here? Every healthy person has a lock on this one. Every healthy person has this unswerving authenticity to follow the pathway that God has called them to follow in spite of what anybody else has to say about it. Because they know this is what God wants for their life. in spite of what this group or this person might have to say, or these even parents might have to say, I know that this is the pathway God is calling me to follow. Look at the next passage. It's the next couple verses down here in the beginning of chapter 4 of Ephesians. And it says, I love this. Paul says, I want you to get out there and walk. And then he says, better yet, run. Run. Run on the road God called you to travel. Are you doing that this morning? Are you walking down that path? Are you running down that path God has called you to travel? And then he says, I don't want any of you sitting around on your hands. I don't want any of you strolling off down some path that goes nowhere. But when you fall victim to the disease to please, that's exactly what you do. God, follow God on the road he has called you to travel. Unswerving authenticity. Profound significance. That has to do with your relationship with your Heavenly Father. Unswerving authenticity. That has to do with your relationship with you. The third thing and final thing I want to leave you with is self-giving love. If you want to be healthy, emotionally, spiritually, relationally healthy, this is central. Self-giving love. And you can see how these kind of build on each other. The first one has to do with God. The second has to do with you. This last one has to do with everybody around you. Self-giving love. And this is where you really begin to love the life you live. When you begin to embody this capacity, you begin to transcend your own needs and recognize other people's needs. Life gets pretty exciting. How many of you have teenagers at home, by the way? Okay, a lot of you. So, Mom and Dad, what's the number one goal that every teenager on the planet has? They never articulate it. They don't say it out loud. But what's their number one goal? Do you know? It's identity. Developmentally, it's to answer the question, who am I? Who am I? And so when you're a teenager of a certain age, you walk into, well, it's almost like you're wearing mirrored sunglasses, but you've taken the lenses out and you flip them around and you put them back in the frames and you look out at the world and what do you see? A reflection of your own neediness, right? And you don't have to be 13 to be doing that. You can be 30. You don't have to be 14, you can be 40 and be stuck there, right? It's kind of like when you go into a social setting at a certain developmental period and there's a bunch of people in there, the number one question you have in your mind is, what do these people think of me? How am I doing, right? How's my hair? Think people are going to like my hair? How about my shoes? People wearing these shoes? These shoes good? How about my pants? Are they good? Are they low enough? I can't tell, you know? That's all identity stuff. That's all about identity. But ultimately, you mature and you get to a place where you can walk into a social setting, and the question is no longer how am I doing, but how you doing? And you really mean it. And your focus begins to be on other people, not just on yourself. And when you begin to kind of hone that skill, right, and begin to give your own life away to other people, that's when life gets pretty exciting. And I know for some of you, you're probably thinking, well, yeah, how do you know if you're doing that or not? Like, I think I'm there, but I don't know, you know? Here's the best barometer, I think, that at least that I've found. You can read about it in the greatest lecture ever given, the greatest sermon ever preached. We call it the Sermon on the Mount. And it's radical. Have you read it lately? It is radical. I mean, it's revolutionary. The stuff that Jesus says in this sermon is so incredible. And he says this one thing in the sermon. In fact, I was reminded of this a little while ago because I had a bunch of airline miles that were going to expire. I'm on the road quite a bit, and I had airline miles. And I remember I went into Leslie, and she was in the kitchen. I said, hey, we got to use these miles or they're going to just be wasted. And she said, that's the last thing we need to do right now is get on an airplane. And she said, why don't you go someplace with your dad? And I said, hey, that's not a bad idea. I called up my dad living in Phoenix, and I said, Dad, I said, I have this thought. I said, I have just kind of this hankering. I would love to go to Rome, Italy. And I know you've been before, and I thought maybe we could go together. You could kind of show me around. And he goes, son, that's fantastic. He said, let's do it. I said, terrific. I said, well, here's the deal, Dad. I said, I'll pick up the airfare for both of us if you want to pay for everything else. And worked out pretty good for me. And we went to Rome, and we just had the greatest time, and we went to the Sistine Chapel, and we went to the, you know, the catacombs, and all that stuff. But one night, we were having dinner in the hotel dining room, and Dad reminded me of something I remember studying as a kid in seminary when I was going to school, and I just hadn't thought about it for a while. But in the days of the Roman Empire, at the time of Jesus, when he was gathering this band of disciples and going around and preaching his message. During that time, the Roman Empire, you know, they occupied the Holy Land there, and it was such a tumultuous political season. And anyway, one of the things that Rome had these folks do is require any little kid carry a Roman soldier's backpack in 1 mile in either direction from his home. It was kind of a way to give the soldiers a break, and so it was just a common law that they would have these kids carry the soldier's backpack. And so in those days, every kid was so, at least that was kind of with it, would mark out that Roman mile in either direction from his home, and he'd put a stake in the ground, he'd put his initials in it and carve it so he knew exactly how far he'd have to go, and then set the backpack on the other side and go there, you know, did what I'm supposed to do. And it was such a common practice that Jesus used it in his sermon, in the Sermon on the Mount, when he said, hey, you want to do something radical in your relationships? You want to do something that's going to change your relationships forever? He said, don't just walk the first mile. Everybody does that to clear their conscience. Do another mile that nobody sees coming. See what happens in your home when you do that. See what happens in your marriage when you do that. See what happens in your friendships when you begin to walk another mile that nobody is asking for. See what happens at work when you begin to walk the extra mile for other people. It's transformative. If you're wondering whether or not you have a lock on self-giving love, I think that might be it, walking the extra mile. And I know some of you are going, well, I don't know, walking the extra mile, that's, I got to Google that. That sounds hard, you know? I got a budget for that. I got to think that through. I got to make some plans if I'm going to do that. No, no, no. You're going to have the opportunity to walk the extra mile before this day is done. Because we walk the extra mile in big and extravagant ways sometimes, but most of the time we walk the extra mile in pretty mundane efforts along the way. Tuesday nights, I take out the trash. Been doing that for a long time in my marriage. Take that trash out there on Tuesday nights. I walk the first mile every time I take out the trash. I walk the second mile when I don't say anything about it. You follow me? Yeah. We have all kinds of ways to walk the extra mile, big, extravagant ways and pretty mundane ways as well. Look at this next verse that Paul gives us. It's all in order here. The next verse here, chapter 4, verse 3, and he says, pour yourselves out. We're talking about self-giving love here. He says, pour yourselves out for each other in acts of love, alert at noticing differences, and quick at mending fences. Pour yourselves out for each other in acts of love, alert at noticing differences, and quick at mending fences. Isn't that wild? Long before we did all of our research and all this, Apostle Paul was talking about profound significance, unswerving authenticity, and self-giving love. You get a lock on these three things, you will love the life you live. Why? Because your relationships can only be as healthy as you are. If you try to build intimacy, if you try to build a connection with another person before you've done the difficult work of getting whole, getting healthy on your own, all your relationships become an attempt to complete yourself. And they'll fall flat until you realize that ultimately our compulsion for completion is met in a relationship with our Heavenly Father. Pastor, you must love preaching here. These people know how to listen. They know how to laugh, and they know how to listen. Those are my two favorite things from an audience, and you gave that to me this morning. What an honor to get to speak to you today. Thank you so much.
How many would say, like me, I could listen to that over and over and over again? I think that's probably the outline of the college course. I'd like to take that class. Very, very helpful stuff. And let me encourage you, if you're here today and you don't have a relationship with God, you haven't completed, there's that hole, there's something missing. I just want to encourage you to trust Jesus Christ to save you. The gospel of Jesus is very simple. We're sinners because of our willful decision to disobey God and His word. We've fallen short. We've left short. But God made up the difference by sending Jesus to pay a penalty for this, for sin, which is, the Bible says, is death. When we put our trust in Christ to save us and choose to follow Him, the Bible says that our sins are covered, and we now become part of God's family. And there's something that happens on the inside of us spiritually that begins to affect the rest of us. So if you're not following Jesus today, I invite you to serve Him and follow Him. We've got more information at our Next Steps tent out in the hub. If you'd like to learn more about that, I encourage you to do that as well. We praise God for that. Dr. Parrott, why don't you come back here for a second, and I want to encourage you to encourage our church. I really want to encourage everybody to check out the table of resources that you have out there, because this is really good stuff. And again, part of our vision here at the church is for you to grow and be strong and be healthy. That's what the next series is about as well. So just take a minute and encourage everybody the resources that you recommend.
Well, I appreciate you asking me about this, because what we did, and this is just the same bundle we had at Fight Night. So if you didn't make it to our event for couples this weekend, you can pick up the bundle that we did there, and we sell it for a little discount. It has three books in it. And the first one is The Good Fight. And this sounds like we're going to have an altar call. I've never given a commercial for my books with background music before, but I'm just kind of feeling mellow about my books all of a sudden. So keep it down back there if you would. That's the message. The Good Fight is really it's for anybody that's ever had conflict. Raise your hand if you've ever had conflict with somebody. All right, there you go. So this book is for you, and it really is practical. It's our answer to how do you really use conflict to your advantage to bring the two of you closer together. Conflict is the price we pay for deeper intimacy, if you know how to fight a good fight. So that's what that one does. This book, Saving Your Marriage Before It Starts, by far and away is our bestseller. It's been used by more than 1.5 million couples. And this is, you know, we really wrote it for the front end of lifelong love. But we know from the feedback we get that couples at any age or stage seem to benefit from it. But you can give this as a gift. And I'm going to be back there to sign books, too. So if they want to give it as a gift, I can sign it or what have you. And then the last book in the bundle is called Crazy Good Sex. And I know this is one of your favorite books, you told me. And
we're going to do a series about it.
I told the group this weekend that I never did intend to write a book on sexuality, but my publisher kind of cast the vision for this, and anyway, I ended up writing it. And I told the group this weekend that when it did come out, I was preaching in Phoenix, and before I went out on the platform, we were backstage, and my mom, 83 years of age at the time, was back. There were 6 or 7 people in the room, and somebody brought in the book. It was brand new, and they said, "Hey, your book's just got here." And my mom said, "Oh, honey, you have a new book?" And I said, yeah, I do, Mom." And she said, "Well, you usually tell me about the books you're writing. What is this book?" And I said, "Yeah, I somehow forgot about this one." And she said, "Well, let me see." And so I handed her the book. She's 83 years of age, all right? Still her little boy. And so I handed her the book, and she looks up at me, and she said, "Oh, honey." And she starts to look at it, and then she closes it shut, she hands it back to me, and she says, "Just tell me you didn't dedicate this one to me." So... So this little bundle is back there. And by the way, I want you to know you can feel good if you do happen to buy this little bundle from us back there. Any proceeds that happen to be raised in this will go to needy children. And so I want you to feel good about that. Both of them live with us in Seattle. And And we'd like to see him go to college. So if you would, buy the book. So play that music now. White boy. I'm going to head out here.
Okay. So Dr. Parrott will be out in the hub after the service. Check out those resources, and he'll be happy to sign those books for you. I want to encourage you to take one more step. We are starting 5 new small groups, all focused on marriage. And so if you're not part of a small group and you're married or engaged to be married, we want to encourage you to step in and become one of these groups. And again, out in the hub, there's a table there where you can find out more information. We have one small group specifically for engaged couples. There's a lot of folks in our church that are engaged to be married, and they're going to use Saving Your Marriage Before It Starts. Some of the other groups are going to use the Good Fight book, and then there's a curriculum that Dr. Parrott created called Deep Love. And so if you're interested in that, let me encourage you to get involved. It's a one-time thing, just for a few weeks, and I think you'll be blessed to be part of that. Amen? All right, why don't you stand today? Let's ask the Lord to bless us. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face shine upon you. May God lift up his countenance upon you, be gracious to you. May the Lord give you peace. May you be blessed in Jesus' name. We love you. Have a wonderful day.